Girl, I started talking about evil, and next thing you know, the light done went out. All right, now. All right. We not finna cut up today. Listen, I'm not sitting in front of the green screen. Y'all let me know whether you prefer me sitting in front of the green screen for these kind of videos, or if this is okay, because... What's going on, y'all? Welcome back to another video. I am very excited about this one because I love this rewrite series that we've been doing. And this week we're going to do Matthew Tate. And I had so much fun with the Seer video. I'm just excited. I'm excited to talk about it and I'm excited to see what y'all think. And before we get started, please remember to like the video, subscribe to my channel, and turn on the little notification bell so that you always get notified when I have something coming out. And please feel free to leave any comment that you have in the comments below. Listen, I'm trying to get better at responding to comments. I promise I am. It's a struggle for some reason, but I promise I'm trying. So today we are here, like I said, to talk about Matthew Tate and how I would rewrite his storyline. For those of us who maybe need a little refresher on who Matthew Tate is, he was Melinda Warren's lover from back in the cut, but he turned out to be a warlock and he actually betrayed her. And he is the reason that she was burned at the stake. So in retaliation, she cursed him into a locket and only one of her descendants could open the locket. So in modern times, Hannah and Rex fool Prue into opening it so that they can prove, number one, that she is in fact Melinda Warren's descendant. And, you know, they bring a Matthew Tate in. So hopefully he can take care of them in like Rex and Hannah's mind. So Matthew had actually copied Melinda's powers back in the cut. But when she cursed him, she took those powers back or took away the copies of them. I feel like I'm the one that's confused on that because I think it just stripped him of the powers that she copied. Anyway, his mission is to take out Melinda's descendants and copy their powers. So the charmed ones, because he comes after Prue first, you know, clearly. So he copies Prue's power and he is in complete control of it. Like this man jumps from a window. So the sisters summon Melinda so that they can take care of him. They decide to curse him back into the locket instead of vanquishing him. But that's neither here nor is it there. Now, by the end of the episode, he does actually end up copying all three of their powers, but he only gets Piper's like literally at 0.100. Like it is literally right when he's about to go back into the locket. So that's his story. I know that was very quick, but I just realized that if I spend 20 minutes talking about his story, that's going to take up too much time. And I want to make like long form videos, but I don't want to spend too much time dwelling on the story because we all know what it is. Also, as an aside, and this has nothing to do with Matthew, but when they bring Melinda Warren back, like she's fully alive and she has all three of her powers. Like they literally bring this woman back from the dead and I'm trying to figure out how. But anyway, that is a video for a different day. So this story was pretty good to me. I actually really liked it. I like the way that they give us that little backstory of Melinda. And then Melinda gets to have a really sweet moment with them. See the charmed ones come to fruition. She gets a chance to meet these sisters from her vision. And it's really nice to have the girls feel like they have that family connection. Because with Graham's gone, the three of them are really all they have. So it's nice to see them kind of bond with her. But then it's sad because they have to say goodbye. Which is unfortunately a theme for them, especially in the earlier seasons. Is seeing someone they really care about and then having to say goodbye. And that person has to go. So overall, I think the story was successful. I loved Matthew as a villain and I wish that he had stayed longer, but we're going to get into that. And not just because he was very good to look at, but he was cunning. He was smart. I think the only thing was he was kind of cocky. And he was reckless to a certain extent because he wasn't from that time. And so it was like, I think he was just kind of used to being able to do whatever he wanted to do. And there were no cameras back then. There were no, you know, police necessarily. So people weren't following you and following leads and going after you. Like that kind of stuff didn't exist back then. So I'm not quite sure how evil operated, but I think that's another part of why he felt comfortable to just like do what he wanted. The only thing I will say is that I wish it would have gone a little bit more into Melinda and Matthew's story, but I understand that this was not a show about Melinda, and so we couldn't spend that much time on her. So I fully, fully understand that. I just wish we had gone just a little bit deeper into it. Now, one of the first things that I personally, as Galen, would change, I would make this a multi-episode arc. That's number one. Let's just go ahead and say that right off the bat. I would make this at least two or three episodes, because that would give us time to kind of go into his history with Melinda. We could get some flashbacks. You can get Phoebe visions of the past. I mean, whatever, because this is the first episode, I believe, where Phoebe's power grows and she's able to see the past instead of just the future. So, I mean, like, come on. You know what I mean? Like, this would have been such a good moment to have that multi-episode arc and to watch Melinda maybe bond with them over each of their power and have time for her to explain, like, well, this is how I used my power. This was how I used this power. You know, this power was my favorite because it was da-da-da-da. Like, we could have had those moments with her if we had more episodes. And then I think that would have given Matthew more of a chance to kind of learn that he's not in his own time. So even though he does, you know, he knows that, I think it would have given him that opportunity to be a more fleshed out villain. And maybe he could have said, like, evil does not work the same way it used to. I don't care for this system because it's too all over the place. Or you could even say that he thinks that it's too structured. Like, when he was alive, you know, when he, not alive, but back when he was active and out of the locket, you know, evil did this. Everyone was working for their own gain and their own mean, you know, but they still came together. Like, he could say now, like, that's why you're not getting things done, is because everyone is too structured and you have to answer to this person and that person. Something like that. So then we could kind of get that backstory on, like, this is why evil is the way it is, especially because they didn't have the charmed ones. So they didn't have the charmed ones to contend with. They may not have even known that the charmed ones were going to come to fruition. Maybe Matthew is the one who told them about Melinda's prophecy, and because he heard it when she, well, no, he couldn't have heard it when she was on the stake because he was already in the locket. Ooh, maybe she had shared it with him already. Maybe she had already told him about the charmed ones, and so that's why he was trying to get her gone, but she already had her daughter. I don't know. I'm gonna come back to that because I feel like there's something in there with that they could have done with Matthew. But let's move on. Now, speaking of her daughter, I do want to say that this rewrite was kind of difficult for me because, like I said, I do really enjoy the story for what it was. I almost wish that they had done like a maybe he was Melinda's father type situation. And I'm not really sold on that because I don't think that everything needs to be a who's the daddy storyline. But the reason I say I would have maybe toyed with it just a little bit is it would have spiced the story up. It would have, besides him being her lover, it kind of would have explained why she felt so betrayed and also why she felt like she needed to make sure he wasn't there to get in the way of, like, Prudence's future and her destiny, because maybe she was scared that he was gonna take her and raise her in evil, and then those charmed ones that she had predicted would actually be evil witches. I think another way that they actually could have tied that in is to say that maybe that's why the Warren line always falls for the bad boys, right? So maybe that's why they always kind of, like, Grams fell in love with the necromancer, Phoebe fell in love with Cole, Phoebe's past life fell in love with Anton. Like, you could kind of go into maybe they're drawn to evil for more than just the fact that they're, like, it's magic and it's like the good, like, you could go into that a little bit and say, like, maybe their evil side is drawn to that. Baby, that would have ate. I'm not gonna lie, I probably would have done something like that. I probably would. But then I think that kind of takes away from, like, them being good witches. And not the light went out, child. Girl, I started talking about evil and next thing you know, the light done went out. All right now. All right. We're not finna cut up today. Apparently, we finna just wing it without a light for the rest of the time because my other ones, they be acting up too. So, child, y'all just gonna get what you get today. But anyway, I do think that would have been a good way to kind of tie that in. And I don't think you have to say, yes, this is Prudence's father, because from what I understand, like, they were having an affair, but what if it had been like a long-standing affair? And so, like, Melinda was never 100% sure, and then when Prudence started to manifest magic, maybe she didn't manifest any kind of warlock powers. And so it was like, okay, well, you know, it must be cool then. She must just be half human and half witch. But maybe that's why, like, Phoebe's past life developed the fire power. Like, yes, we know witches have pyrokinesis, but maybe hers was a little different. Maybe hers was, and it was like, hers feels different, and the power was kind of corrupting her because it was the original warlock side of her starting to kind of like grow. But then also I think that could be a good way to say, well, this is what a warlock's natural power is. They don't have natural abilities. They copy other witches' powers, which, I mean, they do. They can blink, even though they kind of made... So Matthew stole the power to blink from a witch, and then it became a normal warlock power, whatever. So you can kind of explore that. But again, I am not committed to that storyline, and I don't think that was necessary, and I don't know that I would actually include it in a rewrite. I think that would be more of like a fan fiction type situation for me. Now, one thing I think I actually would have put in the episode, like, for real, if I was a writer, is I would have explained why Melinda didn't vanquish him, but she chose to banish him and curse him into the locket. Now, on one hand, you could say maybe she didn't have the power to vanquish him, but I'm not sold on that. I feel like she could have vanquished him. I think she did it specifically so he could suffer. Boom. I think that's what it is. I think at the end of the day, Melinda wanted him to suffer, and she put him in the locket. And then I think you can kind of get into, from like a narrative perspective, you can have the sister sort of struggle with that, because how are we supposed to trust this ancestor of ours who is, you know, a good witch, but she's mad at this man, this warlock, for betraying her. And so she curses him into an eternity in this locket. And then it's kind of like, well, but he's also a demon. So how, you know, and you get that duality of the story. It's like, yeah, she cursed a demon into the locket, but she cursed the demon into the locket because of what he did to her. So it's like, you see what I'm saying? That gets very iffy. And I think especially in season one, where someone like Piper is really struggling with being a witch, and she's, you know, we did see the episode where she was struggling with, you know, being a good witch and what that meant. Can there be a good witch? And she felt like she was evil. That would have been a good way to kind of explore that a little bit more with Piper, and maybe have her be adverse to magic even more than she was, and like kind of refuse to use it because she's scared that she's gonna turn into Melinda and she's gonna get mad at someone and she's gonna try to curse them and whatever else. And then they can move into, well, things are different now because we can vanquish demons. We can vanquish the demons that hurt us. But it's not really about that. It's more so about the fact that, well, what if a mortal man hurts me? Am I gonna curse him? Even though we know, and she knows, that she would never do something like that, if there's one thing that the show has taught us, it's that things change. People change. Their experiences can shape the way they view the world. So just because we know that the Charmed Ones would never curse somebody willingly, necessarily, that doesn't mean anything. Because what's even funnier about this, now that I'm actually thinking about it, is that in season 8, Piper does turn reporters into, what did she turn them into? Mice? She turned them into something. I can't remember what it was, what she turned them into. But she kind of does do that later on. So you get that, like, even though she wasn't cursing them into a locket, she still used magic because she was annoyed with them. So it's like, I think she would have been a really good POV character for that kind of storyline. Like, what is magic going to turn us into? And then leading into season 2 with Morality Bites, we get to see how magic can actually corrupt you. So I think that would have been a good gateway into finding out, you know, kind of questioning, like, why did Melinda do this? Why did Melinda make the choice to curse him, and then get into how magic can, when you know you have access to powerful magic and that you can use it how you want to, it can change your perception. That would have been a good storyline. Because this episode framed Matthew kind of interestingly to me. I use the word interesting a lot, and I need to stop. It framed Matthew in such... It framed him in a way where it was like he was so powerful, and Prue was like, we've never gone up against anyone like him. And then they had to summon Melinda back. And even though the power of three was there, and Melinda was like this very powerful witch who was literally at the, you know, beginning of their line, their magical line anyway. Why are we cursing him back into a locket? Just vanquish him. Like, just use the power of three. Why are we cursing him? Even if you want to use the power of three and Melinda's magic at the same time, and, you know, all of them cast a spell at the same time, they don't have to use like a power of four situation, but you could have it to where like they're casting a spell and Melinda is also. So you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know. There was something very strange about that to me. Very, very strange. But I'm gonna let that go. I'm gonna let it go because it is what it is and that's over. Now, if you have followed me for any amount of time, you know that I'm going to bring up the Roe Coven every single chance that I possibly can. I would have taken this opportunity to tie them to the Roe Coven. I would have absolutely, and I can't remember if this episode comes first, or I want to say this episode came first and then the Roe Coven came later. Now, how would I have tied them in? Especially with maybe potentially the Roe Coven. Girl, I don't know. I don't remember the sequence of episodes. Yes, I could go Google it. I'm not going to. There's no point in me lying to you. I'm not going to go Google that. But the reason that I bring up the Roe Coven so much is because they were wasted. They were such a wasted opportunity. And the way I would have tied them in is as Matthew was going back into the locket, I would have had him say something like, kind of echoing what Jeremy said, like Jeremy when he was like, you cannot stop my kind. I would have had Matthew say something along the lines of, mine will come after yours. And then it could have been something very quick after that. I will still have my revenge through whatever, like however you want to phrase it. Like he could have done something cryptic like that. And then Melinda and the sisters be like, what is he talking about? And Melinda's like, I don't know. He's just a fool who's trying to scare us in the moment. One of the things that I'm thinking here is, what if Matthew maybe wasn't the father of the Roe Coven? Like he wasn't the father of the brothers, but what if he was like the grandfather, their grandfather? And like, their father had bred with two female warlocks, but then he fell in love with a human, you know, whatever else, blah, 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 blah. So then you get that dichotomy of like, Melinda has started this very powerful line of women, and then Matthew has started this very powerful line of men, and now that magic is gonna clash at some point, and we get that hint here that someone is coming. Now, the downside to doing something like that, because I was going to say, that you'd have to cut out Prue and Brendan's little romance, but that's only really if you make Melinda and Matthew have another child, or if you say that Prudence had two kids and then one of her kids turned out to be a warlock, and so she gave them up, like something like that. It would have to be maybe like something like that. But I'm just going to say, for the sake of saying it, that that is not what happened, and that like their lines did not mix at any point for this storyline. I'm going to say that it's a completely separate thing where he had a son with a female warlock and then it continued on, so that way the power is pure. It's not like whatever by witchdom. Although I will say that, okay, that would actually make sense as to why maybe Brendan has that good side. Maybe it's not just that his mother was a human. Maybe it's not just that. Maybe he also doesn't want to be evil and be, you know, he's not giving into his warlock side because he's part good witch. Like, and his brothers are well, I don't know. Because he would be a half sibling, there's a lot of like what ifs that goes into this. And so maybe I don't know. I think I'm just going to leave their line separate, because there would have to be a lot of like who is whose parent, things like that. So what we're just going to stick with for the sake of this argument is that Matthew had a completely separate child, separate from Melinda. But that's what I'm saying. It's like the two of them clashing. It could also feed into that notion that history repeats itself. So Brendan and Prue have their thing going on, just like Matthew and Melinda did back in the day. So it's like a continuation. It's like a revisiting of this thing that they had in this great romance. Boom. You see how we just did that? Do you see how we just connected the dots? Baby, do you see how we just made a whole new storyline? Girl, don't play with me. Do not play with me. Because we just made a whole new story. I 100% live for that. Hearing that is so messy. But I think, again, Charmed is one of those shows that likes to tell us that history repeats itself. And so it would make sense that through the generations, history would repeat itself. It did it with, or tried to do it with Piper and Leo the same way it did with Sam and Patty. Like, history, baby, history. So I hope that y'all liked my little rewrite. I hope that y'all liked the little stories that I would have tried to make out of this show, because I think that they could have been so fun. And I think that they could have bolstered Matthew and made him more of a presence in the show, especially in season one, where warlocks were kind of their thing. Like, they went up against a lot of warlocks. So this, and then between this being something that ties them into their ancestor, and then Nicholas, and if you haven't seen my Nicholas video, please go watch that. I think you would actually really love it. Tying Nicholas into that, making him a part of their backstory, I think it could kind of show more about how important warlocks are in the history of witches. They probably could have used that to explain a little bit more about how like witches and warlocks are tied. And Matthew would have been such a good introduction into that story. Oh, it would have been so good to learn more about warlocks through Matthew. So in my head, in my own little corner, in my own little head, I just want to take a quick little moment to shout out our patrons on Patreon, and for everyone who supports me through TikTok Live, thank you so much, as always, for being here for me and for supporting me financially and for supporting the channel financially. You're going to be the reason that we take off, because I don't know, I just get this feeling that like one day we're going to skyrocket. Like one day we're going to be everything. We're gonna be at panels, we're gonna be here, we're gonna be there, we're gonna be doing a little bit of everything, and it's gonna be because of you. So if you or someone you know would like to support a creator like me, and you would like to support the channel, please feel free to head on over to patreon.com/powerofg. You can sign up for the $3 tier, the $1 tier, or you can just sign up for free so that you can get updates. The $3 tier does give you access to everything in the $1 tier, as well as the link to the GroupMe group chat and to our weekly Zoom watch parties. So thank you so much to everyone who tuned in. Thank you to my supporters on Patreon and in TikTok Live. And I'll talk to y'all hussies in the next video. Bye.